Greetings, everybody. Bob Lusk here, the Pump Boss, checking in from beautiful Gordonville, Texas on this rainy Wednesday afternoon. Glad you guys are here, getting ready to join up with us and talk a little bit about what's going on with ponds and lakes. Today's topic, we're going to talk a little bit about a checklist for spring ponds. So, I'm going to kind of stand back and let a few people join in. Looks like we've got one person on board getting ready to do this. Pond Boss, Jim Fritch is on. He's saying, hey, I'm going to go ahead and like this video. Good for you, Jim. And I've got your question right in front of me, bub. Jason Nepstad, he's on. Greetings, Jason. How's it going? Hello to you. We're going to kind of just stand by and let a few more folks join us. Jim Liner, all the way from Montgomery, Alabama. Hey, Jim. Hope you guys aren't flooded out over there. It's been If it ain't raining at you, it will be. Hi, Scott. Scott Lindsay's on. Good to see you, brother. We got a lot of things to talk about today. And be sure and throw some questions at me. I don't mind going off topic, but our main topic today is going to be checklist for spring ponds. That's what we're going to talk about. Of course, I need to get my commercial knocked out. Pond Boss Magazine comes out every other month, but you know that. If you haven't subscribed yet, please do that. So, let's go with it. Hello, Jim. It's $35 a year. Pretty inexpensive, really, for the knowledge that you get from Pond Boss Magazine. The resources you've got available are our website, which you got a lot of videos, articles, things like that are free. Now, just keep in mind what fuels the economy and allows all this to be free is this right here. So I want to solicit you guys to subscribe to the magazine. A number of you guys are subscribing. I deeply appreciate that. And I don't mind sharing knowledge. If you don't mind sharing a check from time to time to help us pay for all these fun things that we do and the knowledge that we share with you guys. Also, we have several books for sale. Perfect Pond is a good one. If you're getting ready to buy some land or you have land with ponds on it, kind of takes you through what to expect. We got, here's a chapter, Starting at the Start. That's a good place to begin, isn't it? But it's everything from how to buy land, what to look for, questions to ask. Talks a little bit about the backbone of building a lake. Hey, Tori, glad you're on, buddy. Glad you're there with us. Greetings. Also, don't forget about Mike Otto's book. This is pretty dadgum cool. I got to tell you about this. Just Add Water, Mike Otto's book. He started writing for Pond Boss probably 15 years ago. So, you know, when you talk about bulldozer operator, bulldozer driver, builder of lakes, and writer, those two things don't normally go hand in hand, but with Mike Otto, it goes in real, real well. Hi, Troy Todd, glad you're on board. What we're gonna do also is, if you will, in the comments section, hashtag Pond Boss Magazine, all one word, hashtag Pond Boss Magazine. Click like on the video. Hi, Scott Cereal, all the way from Louisiana. Glad you're on board. Hope the feed business is good. Scott's got a feed store in Shreveport. So if you're looking to buy Purina Aquamax in that part of the country, go see Scott Cereal. Friend him on Facebook. He'll tell you how to get there. Bear Brundrett's on board. Hey, Bear, good to see you, buddy. Anyway, if you will do hashtag Pond Boss Magazine, all one word, and click like and share the video, then we're going to put you into a drawing for a Pond Boss hat and the Pond Boss mug. These two things, they're pretty cool. Insulated mug. So do that, and Leanne will draw the name for us next week. Looks like Don Winterrod's on board. Glad to see him. I'm going to take a minute and see if I can get this up on my laptop so I can see your questions a little bit easier. Bear with me 1 minute as I figure this out. It always seems to kind of just show up, but right now it isn't, so I got to dig around for it a little bit, looks like. What we're going to do first is tackle a few questions that came in. If you saw the promo that I did earlier in the week, you'll see that there were some questions that were asked. So I'm going to tackle some of those here in just a second. Here we go. There it is. I see it. Now I've got to blow it up so I can see it. Click to enlarge. Oh, I never remember to turn that dig-gum speaker off, do I? There it goes. It's off. Okay. Anthony Abate's on board. Hi, Anthony. Okay. Good deal. That's it. Yeah, Anthony got it. Don Winterrod got it. Troy Todd's got it. You click like. Don't forget to click like. Hashtag Pond Boss Magazine. Like the video and share it to your news feed. We're just trying to build the audience is all we're trying to do. I'm going to tackle a few questions right quick. Jim Fritch from Central Texas. Jim has asked this question. He says, about suspended clay particles. We had 3 inches of rain Friday. Is that all you got? The lake rose 5 feet and is now extra muddy. Are there gypsum products or liquids to apply to a now 1.5 acre lake to clean that up? Here's what I'm going to tell you first. Stop the source. If you can treat with gypsum, you can treat with alum, you can use lime. It just depends on your circumstance. But what you got to do is you got to, the best you can, stop the source. So if you have bare ground, disturbed soil surrounding the watershed of the pond, vegetate that. Do that as soon as you can. If you've got a creek that feeds into your pond and it's got a lot of clay in it, then I would put some rock gypsum in the creek and let the water flow through the gypsum and dissolve it. Now, there's not too many situations where gypsum won't clear up muddy water. Now, the question is, how much do you need? You know, number one, vegetate the bare soils. If it's clay, you got to fertilize it. You got to figure out how to make grass grow. Now, depending on your part of the planet, that's going to determine the kind of grass you're going to choose. Since this question came from Jim, I'm going to tell you, you probably need Bermuda grass. Common Bermuda would be a good choice for you. Especially, now, you don't need to do that now. Let it warm up a little bit before that happens. Now, how much do you use? I tell you, the best way to figure that out is to go get some gypsum. Maybe get a little aluminum sulfate. Now, exercise great caution if you choose to use aluminum sulfate. And it, you know, I'd probably start with a water chemistry analysis. If any of you want to do a water chemistry analysis, email me here. Our little graphic here, info@pondboss.com. Send me an email. Tell me that you want to do a water sample, and I will send you a form on how to do that and where to send it. And then let's take a look at that. And if we can see, it's either the water's fault or the dirt's fault. And we got to figure out which that is. I've seen it both ways. I've seen well water cause clay to suspend from the pond bottom. But, Jim, since your pond is new, I'm going to pretty well bet you that that's due to disturbed soil that the bulldozer did when he was building the pond. So until you stop those disturbed soils with vegetation, you're going to have a recurring problem. Now, after that, you can take a couple of 1 gallon glass pickle jars, put some pond water in it, leave one as a control, and on the other one, put half a teaspoon of gypsum in it. Mix it up real, real well. Tell you, there are some, if you go online and Google clearing muddy ponds or come to the Pond Boss Forum, we can give you a lot more detailed information and kind of a process how to do that. I don't want to try to explain this when I got an hour to talk about a lot. So you got to figure out which material will be the best to clear the water up. Then you can do that. Let's see what we got going on here. I'm looking at some questions here. Looks like Courtney Shermer is on board. Jonathan Burton, glad you folks are joining us. The second question came from Roger Benson in Missouri. Are there beneficial plants, aquatic plants, that would be good in a bass, bluegill, catfish pond? I have a tiny bit of American pondweed and some cara that the grass carp don't eat. This pond is a 1960s era pond, 3 acres. All the trees were removed when built. 26-foot maximum depth, located in Missouri. No cropland runoff, all timber. Thank you. You're welcome. Okay, here's the deal. We got a pond that is now 58 years old. It has a little bit of American pondweed. Here's the clues on how to answer this question. It's an older pond, so we know it's eutrophied. Oh, that's a big word. What it means is it's got some age on it, which means that over the years, even flowing through timberland, you're going to get leaf litter, you're going to get organic matter that's broken down from the forest. It's going to feed nutrients into that pond, so that pond's probably going to be pretty nutrient heavy, I would bet. Beneficial plants, let me answer that first. Yes, that American pondweed that you have is an outstanding plant, and I like cara. Now, I get some phone calls and some complaints about cara from time to time, but I actually like that stuff, and the reason I like it is it doesn't invade. It's going to, hey, Leanne, glad you're on. Hope things are going well with you tonight. The Leanne is our advertising director with Pawn Boss Magazine. But Kara, one thing I like is it will carpet the bottom in fairly shallow water. Well, we get some complaints about that stuff because it gets thick, it gets dense. But that's a good thing because it does a number of things. It stops, it prevents more of the plants that we don't want to grow. There's my wife, Debbie Dobbs Lusk. Hey, baby, glad you're on board checking us out. We'd love to hear what you think about this. Kara is an algae. It's different from other algaes. It's dense. But another thing I love about it is baby fish love to get in it. Now, when I start talking to you here in a minute about the different checklist things for spring ponds, you're going to see the significance of that. So when I hear a tiny bit of American pondweed and some Kara that the grass carp don't eat, well, we have grass carp. And if you got grass carp, it's going to be tough to get very much aquatic plants to grow, very many of them. So if you want more plants to grow, one thing you can do is build an exclusion fence where you can take some chicken wire and put it around an area where you want the plants to grow and let that start to get more dense. If your grass carp numbers are low, you're probably going to get more plants. Here's another answer to that. Native plants. In your part of the country, sago pond weed, eelgrass is good. Bushy pond weed is okay. Now keep in mind with aquatic plants, and I'm going to get in more detail with this in a minute, need three things to grow. They need the right temperature, they need nutrients, food, and they need sunlight. As long as those three things come together, something's going to grow. If you have those three things and nothing's growing, there's a reason for it. There's reason for it. Okay, Jason Nepstad's chiming in. Chicken wire only lasted 1 year in our lake in the south. You can use plastic chicken wire then. It'll last two. You know, you really only need that chicken wire in there long enough to make the plants grow. So that's the mission. And if you can get some of those grass carp out if you need to, that's a good thing as well. Just focus in on, and I really also remember there's shoreline plants that are good. I love spatterdock, arrowhead, Louisiana irises, some of the reeds, some of the rushes. I don't care too much for cattails because they have a tendency to be invasive and cut you off from being able to come down there and go fishing. Doug Biggs from Bracy, Virginia. I have a 4-acre pond in the South Central Piedmont area of Virginia. The pond will be 3 years old next month. I installed aeration last spring. It was turned off over the winter. When should I start up aeration again? I'm trying to only run it 12 hours at night to save on the electric bill. Is this okay, or do I need to run it 24 hours a day? Well, when you've got a pond that's 3 years old, you haven't had a huge amount of nutrient load build up, most likely. Most likely, depends on your watershed. It's okay. Now, you don't need to turn it back on until the water temperature probably hits 55 to 60 degrees. Then turn it on. Now, keep in mind when you're thinking about aerating a pond, you have two enemies, cold temperatures and hot temperatures. So it's better to run it in the evening at night during the summertime, during the hot times. Have it click on, turn it on your timer from 9 at night, run it till 9 in the morning, then let it turn off. That way you're going to have cooler temperatures in the summer. This time of year, once your water temperature hits about 55 or 60, turn it on at daylight, let it run till dark. That's the way to do it. If you only want it to run for 12 hours a day, which I don't have any problem with that, in a 3-year-old pond out in Virginia, in the Piedmont area of Virginia. Now, those are all key things. Let's see. Anthony Abate from Illinois said, is there any benefit to spring stocking forage like fatheads, shiners, and suckers into a bluegill, crappie, largemouth bass, and tiger muskie pond? Well, I'll tell you this. The answer is yes or no, or it depends. Oh, that's the better answer. It depends. The thing you got to think about is if you have an existing pond with bass, crappie, bluegill, and tiger muskies, fathead minnows will be a complete waste of money. Fathead minnows are good to use in a new pond, or say a pond with catfish only, channel catfish only. That's where you want to use fathead minnows. Don't use them in an existing pond that's predator heavy, a especially with bass, tiger muskies, and crappie. And we'll talk about tiger muskies another time, but I love those where we can use them because they're helpful and help us cull a bunch of the bass that aren't growing really, really well. Shiners and suckers. Shiners could be a good choice. Suckers can be a great choice. Now, the reasons I would choose suckers sometimes over shiners, especially where suckers are native, is because suckers live in a completely different niche. They tend toward the bottom, but they move into shallow water. They're long, shaped like a cigar. The native suckers typically don't get so big that your bass or tiger muskies can't eat them. So I love suckers. Suckers are a good choice. Golden shiners, my favorite time to use golden shiners are when the bluegill are having a hard time keeping up or where the water fluctuates up and down. Shiners are pretty resilient when it comes to water fluctuation. Let's see here. There's Nicole Graney. Hi, Nicole. Alan Williamson is on board. Alan says, at what temperature should the water be for fertilizer to be effective? Fertilizer works best when the water temperature is 55 degrees and going up. Now, here's the catch. You don't necessarily want to fertilize northern ponds. Northern ponds, you got to deal with this thing called winter kill. So if you're adding nutrients to the water column and you don't mitigate that and manage it going into the winter, then you could have some issues with that. But here's an answer for Midwest and southern ponds. Start fertilizing when the water temperature hits about 55 or 60 and the temperature's going up. Now, here's the secret about fertilizer. You have to get it mixed into the water column. Now, check the visibility depth. Make you a Secchi disc or, you know, build one, buy one. Check the visibility. If your visibility is 18 inches or less, don't fertilize. If your visibility is greater than 18 inches, then consider it. Now, the reason you want to consider fertilization is if your water is really, really clear. So if you just have gin clear water, you probably should fertilize it in the Midwest, Southwest, and the South, Southeast, south of the Mason-Dixon line pretty much. And what I would do is if you can buy liquid fertilizer, super triple phosphate, 1034-0, 1137-0, something like that, start off with 2 to 4 gallons per acre, depending on how clear your water is. If you want us to help you come up with a specific recipe, send me an email right there. That goes to several of us that can help you answer. info@pondboss.com. What you're wanting to do is you're wanting to create a plankton bloom that decreases the visibility of the water. Now, the big deal about the plankton bloom is that you want to feed the baby fish when they're first hatched. When a baby fish is first hatched, it has no body fat. So it's got to eat. And when a fish is about this long, its mouth is about as big as the head of a pin, it has to feed by grazing off of plants or filtering things out of the water. And if a baby fish doesn't eat, after its yolk sac is absorbed, it starves to death. And it doesn't take long. It could take 2 hours. So fertile water is real important for that. The second thing fertile water is good for and helps with is to minimize the risk of invasive aquatic plants. If you've got a plankton bloom, healthy green water that's visibility 16 to 24 inches, something like that, then what you do is you block the sunlight off the bottom of the pond and you're going to prevent invasive amounts of aquatic plants. So that's a good thing. Let's see. Terry Guillory's on board. He says, we have an old pond, 20 years old, about half an acre. It's spring fed with no runoff coming in. We currently planted, we planted catfish, bluegill, and bass last spring. We're currently catching 1 to 1.5 pound catfish. Okay, and then it ends right there. That sounds pretty normal to me, Terry. Just if you want to speed things up, then start feeding them a little bit. Let's see. Richard, checking in. Great day tomorrow. Walter is bringing bluegill and red ear sunfish. That is pretty exciting time when you come to stock a pond. You know, one of the things we do with Bob Lusk Outdoors, and of course I'm talking about Pond Boss tonight. Speaking of which, I want to circle back on that now that we have a bunch of more people on board. In the comments section, put hashtag Pond Boss Magazine, click like on the video, and share it to your newsfeed, and that'll make you eligible for a drawing for a Pond Boss mug and a Pond Boss cap. And while we're doing that, let's talk about the winner for last week. Last week, Kevin Briggs is one. So Kevin Briggs, buddy, I don't see you on here tonight, but you will be later on. You're going to be getting a hat and a cap coming up, coming your way. Okay, Anthony, thanks for the response. You're welcome. Don't buy any fat Edmund. Spend that money on fish food. That'll work for you better. Danny Tolliver, our good friend from over at Bell's, Texas. Are crawfish worth spending the money on for bass and catfish? Is it something you have to add each year, or will they breed? That's a great question. Here's the answer. Crawfish have as much value as anything else that you could do for a temporary supplemental food. They're fairly inexpensive. You know, they feed a certain size of bass. So you can actually get a pretty good boost from feeding crawfish. Now, will they establish? That depends on your pond. If you have clay and you have places for them to feed, then they're going to reproduce. But if you don't, see, red swamp crawfish typically are the ones that are bought and sold. Now, don't go buy red swamp crawfish if you live like I see Glenn May from Washington. Don't buy red swamp crawfish up there. Don't buy them in the Midwest. Find out what's native there. Learn about how they reproduce. And then provide them what they need to reproduce. And your odds of them becoming established go up. Now, one of the odds against them establishing is what's eating them. So if you've got an overcrowded bass lake, chances are that the crawfish, unless you've got perfect crawfish habitat, chances are they're not going to be the ones that can get in there and spawn and, you know, reproduce and establish. It just depends on where you are and what you got. Let's see here. John Henry, sorry boss, was late from work. Dude, get on time. Let's go. This is a good thing here. All right. Crawfish answer. Okay, Terry Gallery. We have a 3/4 acre pond that is 20 plus years old, spring fed with no runoff. Okay, we already read that. Didn't see the rest of it. Got that. We stocked, last April, and you've got some catfish. Okay, I got you. Okay. All right. Let's see. Jason Nipstad, our lake is full of carp, and water clarity is about 14 to 16 inches of visibility. I noticed last spring only a handful of bass spawning in our 130-acre lake. Could the carp be the problem because they stay in the shallows during spawning season? If not, what could be the problem? Yes, they could be the problem. What happens is fish have to compete. They have to compete for space. They have to compete for food. Carp, I'm assuming you're talking about common carp. I don't know that for sure, but that's what I'm going to assume, is that you're talking about common carp. If that's the case, when they move up shallow, they're getting ready to spawn. I'm going to talk about that a little bit more here in a minute, about all the different kinds of fish. But they can disrupt the spawn. They can eat eggs. Even though they're bottom feeders, eggs are on the bottom. So they can sure disrupt spawning. And when they're competing for space, they can out-compete a bunch of fish for space. So to answer your question, Jason, yes. Now, if the carp aren't the problem, then it's got to be the population dynamics and maybe the water chemistry. I doubt it's water chemistry in your case. But when you've got 14 to 16 inches of visibility, I'm assuming that short, low visibility is due to muddiness of the water where the carp are stirring the water. Another thing that could be causing it, not only can the carp compete for space and disrupt spawning beds, since they're bottom feeders, they have a tendency to muddy up the water. Muddy water clogs eggs. The shell of, this is pretty cool, you'll like this, the eggshells breathe. And if they get clogged with dirt, they suffocate and the eggs won't ever hatch. So muddy water can be a detriment to reproduction. Let's see here. Terry says, we feed twice a day. We have an aeration system going 24 hours. We also put in dye as needed. Anything else we need to do? No, I think that's a good start. Now, one thing I would not do, I would not put dye in the pond as your spawn is going on. Because what dye does is it inhibits the UV rays of the sun from penetrating the water, which inhibits the growth of plankton, which feeds your baby fish. So it's counterproductive in a fish pond to put dye in. And what dye does, it prevents the UV sunlight, which means it can prevent vegetation. So you kind of got to decide what's more important. Is it more important to not have the plants and use dye or grow more fish? If you want to grow more fish, then you need to use fertilization rather than dye to get some color in the water. Let's see, Billy Birch is on board. Michael Gray. Let's see, Billy Birch is down in Southeast Texas. Billy, glad you're there. Michael Gray from the Central Tennessee area. Marta Howell, our next door neighbor. Glad you're there. Jason, the million-dollar question is the best way to remove the carp or the most effective way. Remind me how big that pond is. I don't remember, Jason. The million-dollar answer could be electrofishing. Now, another million-dollar answer could be trapping. If you build big enough traps, one thing, I'll tell you what you can do. You can start feeding the carp, just buy cheap fish food, feed them into a cove, and when you get big numbers of carp coming into that fish food, run a seine around behind them. Hire somebody near you that's got it's 130 acres. Chances are, 130 acres, you probably have 25,000 pounds of carp. You probably have anywhere between 150 to 200 pounds per acre. If you want to try to remove some, what you can do, I tell you what I would do, not knowing much more about your lake, Jason. I remember now that 130 acre lake, now that I got the nudge. If you can start feeding them on a regular basis and start removing some of them, increase your bass population by stocking more bass. If you can cut off the survival rates of carp babies, then it'll be just a matter of time before the carp numbers will dwindle to the point where they're manageable, even in a 130 acre lake. If you'll feed them a cheap feed into a cove that's clean, where you can pull a seine around them, 100 foot seine, 10 feet deep, do that 4 or 5 times a year, you can remove 5 to 10,000 pounds of carp that way. And then if you can stock some bigger bass, bigger meaning anything 8 inches to 14 inches long over some time, then you can build a big enough predator base to feed on those young, newly hatched carp. I think that's a good choice. So I won't charge quite $1 million because I'm not sure you'll be able to do all that. Give it a try. Purchasing source for freshwater grass shrimp. Tory Rhodes, I'm stumped. I've looked for them. I don't know where you can get those. The reason that you can't buy them is they're not cost effective to produce in commercial fish farms. Nobody does that. Every time I've ever tried to go get grass shrimp, I've harvested those things out of a ditch, you know, or out of a pond. I've got one pond in particular where we did not kill the coontail in that lake, 20 acre lake, simply because that lake ended up with grass shrimp that came in from the watershed. I wanted to preserve those. So you had to educate the landowner a little bit because those things are outstanding. And now that lake is growing some 2-pound bluegills. And I know it's because there's grass shrimp in there along with a good feeding program as well. Let's see. Terry Guillory says, thanks. What kind of fertilization? Most of the time, the limiting factor for fertility in ponds is phosphorus. Now, the further north you go, people don't really like to put phosphorus in ponds. But most ponds, you need phosphorus to go from clear water to fertile water. Now, how much? It kind of depends on the pond. It can be anywhere from 4 pounds to 6 or 7 pounds per surface acre, and some of that is dependent on the chemistry. Higher alkalinity with more amounts of calcium carbonate, lime, that's dissolved in the water. Hard water, take it that way, hard water. A lot of times when you put a high phosphorus fertilizer in there, that fertilizer gets bound by the minerals that are dissolved in the water, and it won't work. It won't dissolve. It just flocculates out. It just settles out. So anywhere from 4 to 6 pounds, 8 pounds sometimes per acre, all the way up. Okay, Terry's in Central Louisiana. Let's see. Yeah, you need to use 10340. Get in touch with Scott Serio. He's watching this video tonight, and he can help you with that. Let's see. Okay, that's the questions we got so far. Throw some more at me. In the meantime, I'm going to go through this checklist for spring ponds. Holy cow, it's already 7 o'clock. Okay, here's the kind of things I want you to think about as we get ready to move into spring. First of all, the daytime's getting longer, photoperiod's getting longer, and the temperature's going up. Now, that's going to trigger a number of things, and right now is the time for you guys to be checking things out. Make sure that be looking for plants. You know, go out there right now and start casting a spoon or something. Drag it across the bottom and see if you've got any plants. You need to know that now. And if you've got plants that you deem invasive, right now is the time to prevent them. Now, you can prevent them with a pond dye. I wouldn't go much later with pond dye than right now. But if you want to get a jump start on plants, first of all, you got to know they're there. So take a little bit of time, go out and scour the pond bottom, especially in shallow water, and see. Measure the clarity of your water. How clear is it? It's real important to know that. If it's 8 foot visibility, that means something. If it's 14 inches, that means something else. Now, here's what it means. 14 inch visibility, you're probably not going to have a plant problem. But if it's 8 feet, 5 feet, 4 feet, you could. So now's the time to be thinking about that. The thing is also, spawning is just right around the corner. As the temperature rises, each species of fish has a little bit different spawning window. Hey, Janine, glad you're on. There's Craig McBride. Good to see you too, buddy. Happy pondering. I love pondering. I'm pondering right now. As fish get ready, you hear anglers talk about the pre-spawn. What that really means is fish are staging themselves. You know, think about it. When they're in cold water, they're cold-blooded animals. They're not real active. Do they eat? Yes. That's why people go ice fishing, because they can catch some fish, because they eat. You know, but other than that, their metabolism rate is so slow that they're not really active. Well, as the temperature goes up, so does their metabolism rate. They're beginning to require more food. They've been slowly developing eggs and milk over the winter. So as the temperature goes up, that starts triggering hormonal change in both the males and the females. And they get into what's called pre-spawn. Well, that's a term saying basically that they're coming out of their winter patterns, their winter doldrums, if you will. They're going to start moving up, getting close to shallow water. Now, that doesn't mean they're going to go from, you know, 18 feet deep in your pond to 6 inches in a day. What that means is they're going to start to migrate up as the temperature rises. Or they might migrate real shallow in the heat of the day, when you have heat, then migrate back down. But once that species of fish hits its spawning temperature, it's going to go do that. Now, what happens with largemouth bass, for example, the males are going to come in first, and they're going to start building nests. And typically, they'll go back to the nest where they were last year. That's pretty cool. And they'll go in and clean it out. They'll sweep it out. They'll use their fins and their, you know, their bottom fins, their tails, and they'll sweep that nest out. It's got to be clean. They want it clean. They'd much rather have gravel or a firm clay bottom, something clean, because instinctively, fish understand that their eggs have got to have oxygenated water migrating through them. If not, they're going to die. So they go in and clean their nests out. Bluegill, they do the same thing, except bluegill are colony spawners. Red ear sunfish are the same. Now, all these fish have different temperature spawning windows. Most of these fish spawn in phases of the full moon. Remember that, especially if you're going to get ready to go fishing. So as you're paying attention to that, be looking for plants. Be looking for, make sure that your spawning beds are available. If you don't have any spawning beds, right now is a good time to build some. What else do you need to do for a checklist for your spring ponds? Pay attention to your equipment. Several of you guys are talking about aeration systems. Well, right now is to follow the manufacturer's recommendations for maintaining it. I mean, you might need to clean the air filter. You might need to change vanes. It depends on what kind of system you've got. Because what you don't want to do is you don't want to go click it on, turn it on, switch it on, and have nothing. You know, or you, better yet, you don't want to get deep into the summer and then something tears up because you didn't change an air filter. So take care of that. Same thing with fountains. Those of you that have fountains, get those managed, maintained right now. Take care of that. Feeders, same thing. Check your feeders. Make sure your batteries are charged. Make sure your timers are working. Make sure they're cleaned out and ready to go. Now, when you start feeding fish, I start feeding my fish when the temperature is about 55 to 58 degrees. We don't feed a lot, but we turn that feeder on, let it spit out half a pound of feed. And then once the fish are coming to the feeder, then we bump it up and feed them what they'll eat within about 3 or 4 minutes. Let's see here. Some more questions coming around. Hey, Bobby Rice. Glad you're on, buddy. Water temperature was 71 here in Florida. Saw a tilapia nest already. Oh, great. Thanks. We're not 71 here. I don't know too many places that are. The thing, now here's something cool about tilapia. Where Bobby is in Florida, his tilapia aren't going to die over the winter. Most places they do. You get up in northern Florida and all the way, say, from central Louisiana, central Mississippi, central Alabama, coming through Waco, Texas, areas north of there, they're going to die in the wintertime, which you really want them to do. You want them to do that. There's Josh Flowers, Twin Oaks Ponds. Hey, Josh, glad you're on board, buddy. Let's see. Don went around. What is good habitat for bait fish when preparing to stock a new pond? Plan on fatheads, golden shiners, and grass shrimp. 1 acre pond, 12 foot deep, average 6 feet in western Kentucky. Well, one thing that you need to do there, Don, is to be sure that you've got some aquatic plants growing. If you don't, since you're stocking grass shrimp and golden shiners, tell you something I would do. I'd put some hay in the water. That sounds a little bit weird, but those grass shrimp are going to migrate to that hay, and that's where they're going to eat and reproduce. Golden shiners will pluck some food off of it. And let's see, what else did you say you had? Fathead minnows. Fathead minnows stick their eggs on the underneath side of firm objects. So you need something in there for them to spawn on. So wooden pallets are good. PVC pipe. Now don't put half inch PVC pipe. PVC pipe, you know, 2.5 to 3 inches or bigger where they can swim in it. And what I would do, if you go buy a 10 foot stick of 3 inch PVC pipe, cut it into 12 inch pieces and then strap them together in kind of like a pyramid and fix it where fish can swim in both ends. That will, your fathead minnows, now they spawn in shallow water. They spawn on pieces of plexiglass. I remember there was one time I had some broken plastic plexiglass off of a billboard that I got somehow, and I cut it into chunks and put some styrofoam on it, screwed it into it, and those fatheads spawned all over that. They spawn on docks, they spawn on trees as well. Billy Birch, what's a good vegetation for a pond without taking over in a bluegill pond? Well, Billy, what I like the best, I like American pondweed in your part of the country. Now, one thing at the bottom, you're going to grow something. You know, that's why when we're designing ponds, we like to avoid that. We like to avoid shallow water as much as possible and actually design where we have shallow water just for that. So we can design, like what we'll do, for example, is we'll design, you know, a 3-to-1 slope coming off the shore down to about 3 feet deep, and then a shelf that is a bulldozer blade wide, then another 3-to-1 slope going down to 6 or 7 feet. And on that top shelf, we will put... Okay, looks like we had a little bit of a loss of power there. Looks like we lost our internet connection for a few minutes. So I just clicked it back on the AT&T thing. So here we go. We'll just try to keep on rolling with it till the internet service comes back on. Which now we do. So I'm going to go back and finish this up. We've got a pretty good storm blowing over our heads right now. Alex Short is on board. Glad to see you, Alex. Looks like Jim Frisch and Josh, looks like they're trying to connect together to maybe do a little bit of business together. Glad we're able to help Josh Flowers and Jim Frisch with our broadcast here. Send me a commission check, boys. All right, let's see. I'm going to keep going here with some of the checklist points. Some of the things, what happens as daylight increases? Well, there's a number of things that happen. The fish behavior changes. The plants begin to grow. The water chemistry changes. Water chemistry, when the water temperature gets up into the 50s and it starts to move higher than that, that's when plankton begins to grow. That's when the aquatic plants begin to grow. That's when the microbes begin to grow and feed on organic matter. The pond comes to life. And as that pond comes to life, there's a whole lot of dynamics going on. Soon you've got fish that are on the beds and they're spawning. And when those, there's Bruce Condello. Hey, Bruce, glad you're on, buddy. We had a little bit of momentary outage there when we lost our internet connection for a few minutes, but we beat that deal. So, for those of you that don't know Bruce Condello, he is an outstanding guy. He's from Lincoln, Nebraska. One of his passions is growing giant bluegill. He's got bigbluegill.com. Check him out on Facebook because you want to see some pictures of some giant bluegills? That's Dr. Bruce Condello's deal. Hey, Willie Howell, glad you're on board, buddy. As the days grow longer and fish begin their spawning, here's what happens. The males clean off the nest. The females come in when they're ripe and ready. They do a little courtship dance. The male bumps the female. She lays eggs. He fertilizes them, then puts them in a clump. And then he'll sit on those eggs. And depending on the species of fish and the temperature of the water, it may take anywhere from 3 days to 15 days for those eggs to hatch. And then when those eggs hatch, you've got a little bitty baseball-sized clump that may be 50,000 babies, little fry, that are absorbing what used to be the yolk of their egg. And then they start to migrate, move around. As they absorb the yolk of their egg, they have to eat. So they got to get out there and go fight. So then they start to eat, you know, whatever they can fit in their mouths. So they're plankton feeders. All baby fish, when they're first hatched, are plankton feeders. They feed on microscopic plants and animals. Now, some of them will pluck bacteria off of plants. But for the most part, they're going to glean their food straight out of the water column. So it's real, real important that you've got some fertility in your water during the spawning. Now, a mentor of mine one time, he and I used to argue quite a bit. He always kept the ponds he managed fertile all year, except when it was the coldest part of the winter and you couldn't. So he would fertilize throughout the course of the summer. I didn't agree with that. And part of the reason I didn't, and I don't to this day, is that the fertility does two things that you want. It prevents the sunlight from penetrating to the bottom to grow unwanted plants, and it feeds your baby fish. Now, since the majority of your fish are spawned in the spring, that's when you need the most plankton. Threadfin shad, for example, they're filter feeders. By the time the middle of summer gets here, if your visibility is decreased to 2 feet to 3 feet, typically it's because they've either run their course or fish like threadfin shad has eaten it. You know, and I like to see the water begin to clear up in the summertime because of the risk that you run of oxygen depletions and a very, very fertile pond. If you've got 18 inches of visibility in August or September, I'd be worried about that. If you have it in April and May, I'd be clapping my hands for you because that's what you want. What are some of the other checklist things for spring ponds? Go fishing. Get your fishing gear in good shape. Be sure that you've got all kinds of stuff ready to go. Change the line in your rods and reels. Do all that. Get it all ready. Make sure your tackle box is good. Bruce says, I see Ray Scott behind you. Did Mr. Scott have any influence on how ponds are managed today? Actually, that's a great question, Bruce. Yes, he did. You know, when I first met Ray Scott, I met him at a fishing show near Dallas, Texas, probably 1996 or 97. I've told this story on this broadcast before, but the part that I didn't tell on this story was one of the first things I asked him was, I know, Ray, that you're the father of catch and release. If it wasn't for you spreading the word through BASS, catch and release wouldn't be the deal, you know, because most people will catch and release to the grease. Well, he's the guy that really kicked that in gear. So I asked him the question. I said, Ray, do you really, really believe in catch and release? He said, Pond Boss, when it comes to public lakes, I completely believe in catch and release. But if you're going to come fishing on my lake, the President's Lake here in Pentlaw, Alabama, we're going to take out every bass 14 inches and under. And when I think we've taken out enough, we're going to double it and take out that many more. So Ray Scott has had an influence in understanding harvest programs more than anything. That's probably what he's brought to the table. The second thing he's brought to the table is some pretty innovative and creative habitat design stuff. He's got some things in his lake that people didn't think about 35 years ago for cover. Not only is he compensated for bass, he's also created some shallow zones. He grows more gizzard shad than anybody I've ever seen, but it's simply because he's got 3 or 4 big coves with water that's 2 feet deep. Perfect habitat for gizzard shad. And if he didn't have gizzard shad, he wouldn't have those double-digit bass that he's got in there today. So that's pretty cool. Daniel Powell. Oh, you must be out of church, buddy. I guess it's 8:15 over in your part of the country. Glad you're on board. Want to remind everybody to put in hashtag Pond Boss Magazine in the comments section. Click like on the video. Share it on your newsfeed, and you'll be eligible for a drawing for Pond Boss mug and a hat. Pond Boss hat. There it is right there. Also, don't forget, if you haven't subscribed to Pawn Boss Magazine yet, please do that. Go to the pawnboss.com website and jump into that. Gene Woods, our good friend. Good to see you, Gene. Bruce, thanks. Great answer. You're welcome, buddy. Brent Rutan, join late. Sir, if you already covered it, how about preventive treatments to get in front of filamentous algae blooms? That's a good question. One thing to understand as you're going through your checklist for spring ponds is that plants have got to have three things to grow. They have to have sunlight, which you can't do a lot of. Well, maybe you can. We'll talk about that in a minute. They got to have food. Can't do much about that. Temperature. Can't do much about that. Every species of plant has its own temperature window. Just so happens filamentous algae starts earlier because it likes cooler water. There's so many different kinds of filamentous algae, some of that stuff starts growing at 40 degrees. You know, and if you wanted to, one thing you could do right now is you could prevent some filamentous algae with some pond dyes. Now, one thing you want is you want that pond dye to fade out and be gone by the time your fish start to spawn. So if you're going to use it, don't overdose it. Go strictly by the label, maybe even cut back a little bit. Now, another thing about filamentous algae is you can use a light dose of algicides just as it starts to grow and you can keep it at bay. Just keep in mind, though, all you're doing is treating a symptom of the problem. It's like mowing the grass. You're going to mow it, but as long as everything else is good to go, it's going to keep growing. So it's not going to be a one-and-done deal. That's going to be the deal there with that. Another thing you can do with filamentous algae, depending on where you are, I don't remember where you are, Brent, but some states allow the use of certain species of tilapia. Tilapia Mozambique are outstanding grazers of algae. We use those in Texas a lot to eat filamentous algae. And what's really cool about that is it takes the nutrients that are bound in that algae and converts them to flesh and then turns around and then we've got more forage fish to feed our game fish. So that's pretty cool. Todd Austin, good job there, buddy. Hashtag Pond Boss Magazine. Thank you. Okay, anybody have any more questions? Bring them on to me. We got another 13 or so minutes. We'll keep clicking. Going back to the plants, because that always seems to be a pretty common series of questions. Plants, native plants in the right areas are the nursery grounds for your stuff. Daniel Powell checking in from, oh boy, you're in, it's 2 o'clock in the morning. Go to bed. My advice to you as a pond meister, it's 2 a.m. You must be smitten with this pond management stuff. I love it. Plants, different, some aquatic plants. I tell you what, if you have a pond that has less than 20%, 25% coverage of native aquatic plants, you have the nursery to grow lots and lots and lots of bait fish. Now remember, it takes 10 pounds of bait fish for a game fish to gain 1 pound. So that's a pretty big deal. So having a safe place, remember what I told you earlier, when a little bitty baby fish is hatched, it absorbs its egg, and then it has to eat. If it's got a good base of aquatic plants like American pondweed, or bushy pondweed, or eelgrass, or some of the other natives, curly leaf pondweed, sago pondweed, depending on where you are. Remember, those plants will cover with microbes and bacterial colonies. Those little bitty baby fish can graze on that. And if you've got some fertility in your water, that bolsters the food chain as well. So there's a number of things you can do with aquatic plants to help become the nursery to grow more bait fish. Grow more bait fish, grow more game fish. That's a pretty good thing. You know, going back to the different plants, remember there's three basic categories of plants. You've got emerged plants. Those are typically plants that grow in really, really shallow water or places along the pond's edge. That's cattails, reeds, rushes. It's water primrose, the little viney looking plant that grows out with yellow flowers on it. Alligator weed, Louisiana iris, spatterdock, lily pads, American lotus. Learn as much as you can about these plants. You've got submerged plants. Those are going to be like the pondweeds and most of the algaes like filamentous algae. There's Cara, There's another vascular algae. I'm not thinking the name of it. Somebody chime in there with it. Then there's coontail and, you know, milfoil, a bunch of plants that grow underwater. Part of your job is to, first of all, learn what you have and be sure you understand how it works, so then you can decide whether it's invasive or not. Then you can decide what to do about it. There's other plants, floating plants. There's not any of those I like. Most of those become a management nightmare. Duckweed, for example. Two little leaves, a little bitty root. Those things are not this big. Little bitty plants. And they reproduce about every 36 hours. And that means it's exponential. It gets to be, you remember I've told you this before, would you rather have a penny doubled every day for 30 days or $1 million? Take the penny. Duckweed, water meal, that's the penny. And part of the reason some of these plants like water lettuce are illegal in some states is because of how prolific it is. So none of the floating plants really help us much. They're more of a hindrance because they can move around and cover up the entire surface of the pond. Diatom algae, Anthony Abati says, I like that stuff. It's part of the food chain. You know, and what it's made out of silica, actually, which is what glass is made out of. So you've heard of diatomaceous earth? Well, that's the little carcasses of diatom algae. You know, but when it's alive, it feeds bigger algae, which feeds bigger algae, or bigger plankton, which feeds bigger plankton, which feeds small insects, which feeds bigger fish. All right, let's see. Shane Tyndall. Well, Shane, that's pretty cool. Giggum from Tunis. Giggum, hey, class of 79, buddy. Wanting to thin out the smaller largemouth, not seeing as many bait fish as I think we should, would you really recommend taking out every largemouth under 14 inches? Absolutely, I would. After the third year, don't harvest fish before the third year of a pond. It pond's life after it's been stocked. So, yes, be sure and start harvesting fish after the third year. And now, if the bass have been overcrowded for several years, you want to take out every one of those you can. But here's the key to that. You want to harvest enough so that the remaining fish are gaining weight. So weigh and measure a few fish so you can track their growth rates. If you see that they're skinny and that they're trending down on the average weight side, then you're harvesting more. But once you finally get to the point where they level off and then the remaining fish start to grow and you see your bait fish numbers going up as your predator fish numbers are going down and your predator fish weights are going up, that's when you know you've taken out enough. You might need to go back and listen to that again. I said it pretty fast. Oh, but you can listen fast. I got you. Let's see here. Jason Nepstad says, are arrowheads bad for lakes, North Carolina? Looks like a lily pad. They have started growing. No, actually, they're not. Arrowhead's a good plant. It will help seize loose soils around the shoreline, prevent erosion, and they bloom. They look pretty cool. A great habitat for little bitty fish. So I like arrowhead. Okay, Tori's question, installing underwater lights under a dock, any advantage or disadvantage to running on it? Yeah, run them all night. Once they come on, leave them on, man, because they're attractive to fish. You can see some of the most spectacular stuff going on with underwater lights around a dock. I mean, Bruce Condello can come up with some stories about that. I can too. The very first time I saw an underwater light was probably 20 years ago. It was called a Green Monster Fish Light, and it was at Ray Scott's place. We'd been invited to come work on the lake and got there, and he said, hey, man, I got something to show you. So he handed me a rod and reel. There were thick three of us. He handed each one of us a rod and reel. He says, look at that. Look out there. And out there off of a retaining wall, probably in water 6 feet deep, he had these two Green Monster Fish Lights side by side, and if there was one, there were 200 bass swimming around in each one. He says, cast right there. Oh, my gosh. The lure didn't hit the water. Didn't even hit the water already before something hit it. But what the coolest thing is about lights is it attracts fish that you wouldn't otherwise see. So it's pretty cool for that. So I'd say, yeah, leave them on. Well, you know, if you don't turn them off at night, save electricity, you can. But they don't use that much electricity, so I like them. Karen Wusher. Greetings, Karen. Glad you're on board. Let's see, Bruce Condello, is there a checklist for checking the integrity of your dam before the big spring rains come? Absolutely. That's a great question. And right now is the time to do that. What you want to do, the number one thing you want to look at or look for is erosion. Right now, it's raining on us right now. In the last probably 7 days, we've had close to 10 inches of rain. I looked at the pond today between raindrops where the overflow pipe on the back had collapsed. So the water was falling. What had happened, it had come disjointed. So where it was disjointed, there was water flowing out that, going straight down, cutting out the backside slope of his dam. I told that guy, man, well, let's get down there now. And water was pouring out of that pipe. I said, let's get down there now and let's pick that pipe up, push it back on, and let's get a sawhorse or something to hold that pipe up so it can't disconnect. And you need to, when it quits raining, get back in here and fix that. So be checking for seepage, be checking for erosion. That's the biggest deal. Make sure your overflow pipes are not stopped up. That's a big deal. An overflow pipe is designed to be the primary spillway for your pond. So go check that out. You know, the other things are look at the inside tote. Do you have erosion there? Do you have winds and waves that are beating it up? If it is, think about, you know, remember the Mr. Goodrich, pay me now or pay me later? Well, if you've got significant amounts of erosion on the inside slope, be a good time to take a look at rip wrapping it, you know, putting some rock on it, which would add habitat as well. Is it going to cost some money? Sure. But it won't cost nearly as much as if your dam collapses and your pond or lake washes away. So making sure that your spillway is clean and clear, vegetated. Make sure that your overflow pipes are clean and clear, that you're not getting exorbitant amounts of erosion. Go back and check the backside tote. The overflow pipe or your spillway should not be eating the inside back of your dam. Willie Howe, what's the best idea to fix a dam break in the midst of so much rain? Nothing. The force of water and the power of water is so intense that you can't do anything about it. Now, if that's your dam, we need to talk about it. But you can't. As a matter of fact, there's one, Willie, not too far from our house. I'll take it and show it. Take you and show it to it. That lake was built backwards in my mind. The guy, for some reason, built, cleaned out the bowl of it, and then started building the dam, and then created a dirt spillway in the middle of the dam. Well, and he added a little bit of riprap. But when we had those torrential floods back in 2015, that water chewed the dirt out from under that riprap. Willie, your dam. Okay, well, here's what you're gonna do. We'll have to. If your dam is getting chewed up, it's because it wasn't compacted well enough with the right kind of dirt. You and I will talk about that. Willie's got a brand new small pond right beside his house, and it's probably not even a 20th of an acre. And we've had incessant rains here, and it sounds like it's chewing the back of his dam. Well, what you need to do is just let it go. And then once this event is over, you get your dirt mover back out there, and we need to go back in. And if the dam is collapsing or being eaten away, it's because there's not a big enough spillway to bypass the water around the dam. You gotta have an area where the water can go around the dam and deposit, dump back into the creek beyond the dam, outside the dam. So we'll have that conversation again. Fred Bingaman, Brownstown, Illinois. Hey, my friend, glad you're here, buddy. Well, it's coming up on 7:29 already. Remember, hashtag Pond Boss Magazine, click like on the video, and share the video to your newsfeed, and you'll be eligible for a drawing. Now I'm going to kind of wrap up. Here's what you win in the drawing. Kevin Briggs won the drawing this time, so that'll be coming in his mailbox here pretty quick. So remember, pondboss.com. Ask the Boss, great resource for you. This Facebook page is a good resource for you. We're pretty good about answering your questions. Pitch them at us, we'll answer them as soon as we can. On Ask the Boss, we've got probably 400,000 posts that track back to 2002. So it's a huge amount of information. If you don't subscribe to Pond Boss Magazine, please do. It's only $35 a year. We spend that much money going out to eat on a Friday night. So thanks again for joining us, and tune in next week. I may have a guest next week if I can convince her to come. My wife, she is fantastic when it comes to amenities around the pond. So, appreciate you joining up. Check us out some more. Share this with everybody. We'll talk to you next Wednesday night.